Okay. So, last class I told you about some disorders of the endocrine system. Hope you remember, recollect some of the disorders. These things I covered. The adenomas of the different cells, I mean different types of cells of the pituitary gland, of the anterior lobe and posterior lobe, I told you. Okay, this is I told. Okay, next coming to pineal gland. So I told about the various important disorders of the pituitary gland. Okay, all the hyperfunctioning, hypofunctioning and the neoplastic conditions. And now coming to this pineal gland. This is a small, tiny organ lying above the third ventricle. Third ventricle. You know the different ventricles, the dilated portions inside the your brain where you find the CSF flows. Okay, you have the lateral ventricles and third ventricle like that. You have lying above the third ventricle. This is the small gland, and this secretes a chemical called melatonin, and that is involved in circadian rhythm control. The circadian rhythm control means the cyclical pattern. You know, the circadian means, you know, we have that invisible biological clock in our body. It is a biological clock. That's why you have that cycles of thirst, hunger, sleep, all those things. Okay. Generally, you know, we have the cycles. You sleep at a particular time. You feel sleepy. You feel hungry. You feel thirsty. The body tells you, it gives a message to you, the feeling of sleep, the feeling of thirst, the feeling of hunger, all these things. Nighttime, you feel like sleeping. It's not that you sleep artificially, you definitely feel sleepy. So like that, you have this biological rhythm or a cyclical rhythm going on in your body. Okay. Even if you are not aware of that, the body is controlled. You know, our respiratory rate, our heart rate. You know, they are not in your hand. You know, even if I am now taking the class, I am breathing, but I am not aware of it. The breathing is going on, because otherwise how can I live? I will die without taking inspiration or the taking of oxygen. Because things are happening like that, you see. So wonderfully the body is designed, and because of these things, so many things are automatically controlled, even if we are not aware of it. Okay, that is how it is designed. The nature has designed our body. So it secretes melatonin, which is involved in the circadian rhythm control, and also gonadal maturation. You see, the same thing, it also is important for the maturation of your gonads, the testes and ovary. You know, without the maturation of gonads, reproduction will be impossible. You know, the reproduction will not be possible at all, and the offsprings will not be produced. The further human generation will stop, you know, the continuation of the human generations will stop. So the gonadal maturation also is required. If it's not matured, how you will get a good quality or normal functioning spermatozoa and normally functioning and good structured or good quality ova. It's not, it's impossible. So you need a gonadal maturation also. That is also under control of various hormones like testosterone, estrogen, progesterone, and so many other things. And it's all controlled by this melatonin, maturation of gonads and the circadian rhythm control. So these things are happening in our body even if you are not aware of it. And that is called pineal gland. And the most important tumors of this pineal gland are germ cell tumors and pineoblastomas. You know, in MGD and FGD chapters, we have told you the various types of tumors, the germ cell tumors also, arising from primitive germ cells in the gonads. Here also we can find some germ cell tumors, because there are also some extra gonadal germ cell tumors, as we told you. There is a germ cell tumor sometimes occur in some other places other than the gonads, other than the testes and ovary. So they're called extra gonadal germ cell tumors. Okay, they can occur in the brain, they can occur in the mediastinum. Okay, there are some cases, some types which are occurring because of some residual primitive germ cells in those areas during the embryological development. So those cells will undergo neoplastic transformation and will develop into germ cell tumors. And also there are the tumor called pineoblastomas. Okay, the pineal gland definitely has some cells which produce this melatonin. So those primitive cells will also undergo neoplastic proliferation to form pineoblastoma. Okay, so these things we have from the pineal gland. So this is briefly about pineal gland. Next is parathyroid gland. You know, parathyroid gland, you know, this is present inside the thyroid gland. I mean, inside the substance of thyroid gland, but it is different from thyroid gland. You know, thyroid gland produces T3, T4, but this produces parathormone. This is produces a hormone called PTH or parathormone. You know it? Okay. Parathormone, and you know the parathormone is concerned with your calcium metabolism. It helps in bone resorption. Action of parathormone causes more increased calcium, serum calcium level. So it helps in the calcium balance in the body. The amount of normal calcium in the blood and the tissues, that is the calcium homeostasis, along with the hormone called calcitonin produced by the C cells, parafollicular cells or C cells in the thyroid. Along with calcitonin, the parathormone, together they will act and they balance each other. The actions will be opposing actions, and they maintain the calcium balance or calcium homeostasis in our body. So that is all about your parathyroid gland. Okay, so there are four parathyroid glands. On the right side, two, left side, two. Right side again upper and lower, left side again upper and lower. That is superior and inferior. Superior and inferior, both sides in the thyroid substance, it is there. Because they are present very near to thyroid, it is called parathyroid. And totally 120 milligrams in weight. An upper pair is derived from the fourth pharyngeal pouch during embryological development and located in the upper posterior surface of thyroid. And lower pair is derived from the third pharyngeal pouch and located in the, and location is a bit variable. It's not the constant. Okay. So this is parathyroid gland. So the three cell types are recognized in the parathyroid gland. There are three types of cells called chief cells, water clear cells and auxiliary cells. Some are called chief cells, or some cells are very having clear water like cytoplasm called water clear cells, and others are called auxiliary cells. There are three types of cells in the parathyroid gland. So actions, the hormone produced by this gland is, this endocrine gland is called parathormone, that is called PTH also called. So its major important role is in the calcium, as I told you, homeostasis means balance, calcium balance. Okay, through the secretion of PTH. So what is its action on the bone? Parathormone will stimulate the osteoclastic resorption. That means it will stimulate the osteoclasts to destroy the bone and release the dissolved calcium into the blood. Okay, you know the osteoblast, osteoclast. Osteoblast means bone forming. Osteoclast means bone lysis. So this is required for the bone remodeling during the bone regrowth or during the bone regeneration or healing, whatever it is. So it stimulates osteoclastic resorption and it inhibits the osteoblasts from forming bone matrix. So in this way, the calcium due to the effect of osteoclastic action of the giant cells, osteoclastic giant cells, they will dissolve the bone and they release calcium from bones into the blood. Okay. So in this way, it increases the blood calcium level by bone resorption. Another action of this parathormone is it reabsorbs calcium while inhibiting phosphate reabsorption. Okay. So again, you know, calcium and phosphate are interlinked. If one is elevated, the other will decrease. If one is decreased, the other will elevated. So this calcium into phosphate is constant. Okay, they are all, they both are also interdependent in their levels. I mean, calcium and phosphate levels. Okay. So hydroxylation and also hydroxylation of 25 dihydroxy vitamin D to 125 dihydroxy vitamin D. You know, the 125 dihydroxy vitamin D3 is called vitamin D. Are called calciferol. So this it has two hydroxyl molecules. So the at the one position, the hydroxylation occurs, and also at the 25 position, this is also by the help of parathormone. It adds one hydroxyl molecule to one position in the kidney. Okay. So these are the effects of parathormone on the bone and kidney, and also on the intestine for resorption of calcium from the. Dietary sources from the food we take, digested food. So, what is hyperparathyroidism? So, there are different causes of hyperparathyroidism, there is a hyperfunctioning of parathyroid gland and production of more parathormone and more resorption, more calcium levels, and there will be osteolysis because of osteoclastic activity and more absorption from GI tract. So, all these things ultimately causing increased calcium level in the blood. So there are again three types, primary, secondary, and tertiary hyperparathyroidism. So primary hyperparathyroidism means due to the gland itself, due to some cause in the gland itself, like you know the parathyroid adenoma. So adenoma means, as you know, Okay. Adenoma, as you know, it is again your neoplastic proliferation of the parathormon producing cells in the parathyroid gland. So you have this parathyroid adenoma, where again there is a more production of the parathormon. And because here the main cause is occurring in the gland itself, it is called primary type of hyperparathyroidism. Secondary means secondary due to some other cause. So it is a physiological response to hypocalcemia. When there is hypocalcemia in the blood due to malabsorption or renal failure, so that is the primary cause. Secondarily, it will lead to. Hello. Chapman. Edema. Ah, Chapman. Okay, sorry for the small interruption. So secondary means, you know, as I told you, the response to some primary cause. So here it is a physiological response to hypocalcemia, which may be due to malabsorption from the intestine or from the kidney failure. You know, the kidney failure also, there can be hypocalcemia, I told you. So there is hypocalcemia. And this hypocalcemia will stimulate the parathyroid gland to produce parathormone. So by a, you know, there is a positive or negative feedback mechanism. In endocrine functions, we know the feedback mechanism. When the target or hormone will be less in number, it will send a positive feedback mechanism to produce the more hormone. And it is, if it is levels is more, it will send a negative feedback mechanism. So this is because of the feedback mechanism. So the secondary response to hypocalcemia will lead to increased parathormone, that is called as secondary hyperparathyroidism. Tertiary means in the setting of a secondary hyperparathyroidism. When there is secondary hyperparathyroidism, that will lead to more stimulation of the parathormone cell producing cells, leading to the neoplastic transformation, and that leads to again hyperparathyroidism. So the adenoma, which is occurring in the setting of due to in the background of secondary hyperparathyroidism, is called tertiary hyperparathyroidism. So like that, we have three different types of hyperparathyroidism. 636, 826. So as I told you, so there are three different ways or mechanisms how there is increased secretion of parathormone. That's why it's called primary, secondary, and tertiary hyperparathyroidism. Okay. The clinical manifestations. So when this hyperparathyroidism occurs, you will find this increased calcium. As I told you, hypercalcemia because of the increased bone resorption and from the bone and also from the GI tract. So there is one increased calcium absorption from GI tract also, so leading to increased calcium level in the blood. It's called hypercalcemia. So this causes these manifestations. So the manifestations are they can be rhythmically remembered as stones, bones, moans, and groans. It means there is formation. There is a more chance of this calcium secretion into kidney and forming kidney stones. This calcium phosphate and the calcium carbonate kidney stones. And also calcium ammonium magnesium phosphate, like that. There are so many stones out there. Okay, calcium ammonium magnesium phosphate and other stones. And also bones. Bones mean there will be painful bones. The painful bones leading to, because you know there's more amount of osteolysis, the osteoclastic activity will become more, leading to increased bone resorption, and so that leads to more increased pain in the patient and also more strain on the bones during physical activity, and that leads to osteoporosis and also fractures. Because calcium content is less, there's osteoporosis, and that can lead to fractures also. Okay, as non-traumatic fractures. Okay, non-traumatic means even without any injury also, during normal walking also, because the bones have become very weak, they undergo fracture. So this is called painful bones. Moans means psychic moans. Psychic moans means sometimes it can lead to interruption of the neuromuscular activity and the activity of neurons because of this high calcium level. That leads to psychological manifestations also. Okay, there are psychic moans. And abdominal groans means abdominal groans means because hypercalcium can lead to your functioning disordered functioning of your GI tract, autonomic nervous system, and your various autonomic nerves controlling the peristalsis and other things. That can lead to peptic ulcer and also pancreatitis. So that is mentioned as renal stones, painful bones, psychic moans, and abdominal groans. Groans means the abdominal pain and other things. Okay, because of peptic ulcer and pancreatitis. Okay, these things. Pancreatitis, because of the increased calcium, can activate the many enzymes of pancreas prematurely when they are in the gland only, and that activation can lead to digestion of pancreas and also autolytic activity and also destruction of pancreas, and that can lead to this inflammatory condition of pancreas called pancreatitis. So these are the different manifestations of the hypercalcemia due to hyperparathyroidism. So laboratory diagnosis by increased plasma calcium level, we can estimate the calcium level if it is much more than the normal reference range, and also decreased phosphate, plasma phosphate. So as you know, because you know, as I told you, the calcium and phosphate are interlinked. If one is increased, other is decreased. So because the calcium level into phosphate level is constant. Okay. So that you have to understand, there is some chemistry in that. So decreased plasma phosphate, increased parathormone because it's hyperparathyroidism, and mild metabolic acidosis because of this increased calcium level. There is also acidosis. Okay. Formation of several acidic substances leading to metabolic acidosis, because it's an underlying metabolic mechanism is there. Okay. As you know, there are two types: respiratory acidosis, metabolic acidosis, like that. In diabetes also, we have this lactic acidosis. We have this keto acidosis. You know, keto acidosis we have because of the all the ketone substances produced and causing more acidic nature or decreased pH. Like that, we have all the examples of metabolic acidosis. In respiratory failure conditions, we'll get respiratory acidosis and respiratory alkalosis, depending on the underlying mechanism, like that. So coming, that is all about briefly about the hyperparathyroidism. Next, coming to hypoparathyroidism. That is a decreased parathormone and also leading to decreased functioning of parathormone and decreased calcium levels. So causes are removal of the parathyroid glands during the thyroidectomy. Sometimes during the thyroidectomy, in case of goiter and other diseases of thyroid, or any thyroid neoplastic conditions, the thyroid gland is removed, and accidentally or knowingly or unknowingly, when proper care is not taken, the parathyroid gland is also removed along with the thyroid as a part of the surgical procedure, and that can lead to a loss or loss or absence of thyroid tissue and decreased parathormone, and that leads to a state of hypoparathyroidism or decreased functioning of the parathormone. So it's the most common cause of hyperparathyroidism. And idiopathic means unknown causes. Sometimes there are unknown causes of non-functioning of the parathyroid because of which the parathormone levels will decrease. And next is the congenital deficiency. There are also some examples where you find congenitally there is deficiency of these occurrence or formation of parathyroid gland. Or this development of parathyroid gland leading to less number of parathormone producing cells. That is called DiGeorge syndrome. DiGeorge syndrome, where you find the aplasia of the thyroid parathyroid gland. Even there is also thymus aplasia also. So decreased number of cells and so decreased production of parathormone. So this is called congenital deficiency or DiGeorge syndrome. So these are some of the causes of hypoparathyroidism. So clinical features of hypoparathyroidism, where you find the hypocalcemia. There, in that condition, you found hypercalcemia because of excess parathormone. Here, it is a deficiency of parathormone, so it is hypocalcemia. So, hypocalcemia, you must already know, you must have read in your physiology what it causes. like titani. Titani, you know, the titani means you have the spasm of your muscles, the spasmodic conditions of the skeletal muscles, where you find the titani, and Wostek sign, trosis sign, where you find the contracture of your hands and the contracture of your other skeletal muscle areas, where you find carpopedal spasm or the other things. So many things are there because of this contraction of these muscles because of hypercalcemia. So they are all the features of hyperparathyroidism. Laboratory features, we can biochemical estimation of plasma calcium will be low and raised plasma phosphate. As I told you, calcium if decreased, phosphate will increase in contrast to the previous condition, and low parathormone. So these are the clinical features and laboratory manifestations of the condition of hyperparathyroidism. Next is pseudo hypoparathyroidism. The pseudo hypoparathyroidism, pseudo is false, a false state of hyperparathyroidism. It appears that there is hyperparathyroidism, but actually it's not. So here it's an X-linked dominant disorder. It's characterized by end organ resistance to parathormone. So here you find it is parathormone is actually there, but the target organs where parathormone has to act, that is in case of bones and GI tract and kidney, so they will be resistant. You find some peripheral resistance of the target cells where the receptors are there for the parathormone effects. So because of resistance, they don't respond properly. When they don't respond, they will not be calcium resorption or calcium absorption from bone and GI tract. So even if the parathormone is acting, it is there, so the calcium levels will not increase. Our calcium levels will not be as required, the required level. So leading to a state of pseudo hypoparathyroidism. It appears as if there is hypoparathyroidism because of less calcium levels, but actually it is not true. Parathormone is there, but because of the target resistance, peripheral organs are resistant to the parathormone, they are not responding properly and they are not releasing calcium. So that is why giving a false impression that there is hypoparathyroidism. Okay, so it's called pseudo hypoparathyroidism. So because of this, there is calcium levels are less. Again, it will send a feedback mechanism to produce more parathormone. Okay, so the parathormone levels will be normal or high. Here it is, even if there is hypocalcemia, parathormone levels are not less, the normal or high. That is a pseudo or a false state, a false impression is created. So it is called pseudo hypoparathyroidism. So just coming to the neoplastic conditions after the hyper and hypofunctioning states of parathyroid gland. So next to the neoplastic condition of the parathyroid gland, parathyroid adenoma. Again, like we have adenoma of pituitary, so we have adenoma of parathyroid also. So it's a small swelling, about 50 millimeters diameter, and almost always solitary or single. And in contrast to hyperplasia, other glands are normal and atrophic. In case of parathyroid hyperplasia due to some reactive condition, you find all the four glands are enlarged in size. But in case of adenoma is a neoplastic condition, not hyperplasia. So where you find some dysplasia and some other neoplastic behavior. So in this case, only one gland is having this adenoma and other glands are normal or atrophic. So that is how you differentiate between hyperplasia and adenoma of parathyroid glands. Okay. And atrophic means decreased in size. Okay. Are normal also. And histologically, you find they're composed of chief cells. Most of you know, as you go to chief cells, water clear cells, there are different types of cells in the parathyroid. So they're composed of chief cells. And clinically apparent due to PDS secretion. Clinically, there is also because of adenoma, they produce the PDH. So clinically, it is also, it can be found out the effects of excess PDH with the hypercalcemia and all the clinical manifestations of hypercalcemia, which I told you, they'll be present in the clinical examination of the patient. So this is a case of parathyroid adenoma. You can see the adenoma, the well circumscribed lesion. Most common cause for primary hyperparathyroidism. A rim of normal parathyroid. This is a normal parathyroid. You can see a rim of normal parathyroid is also tissue, which is the adipose tissue. These are the adipose tissue cells. This is compressed to the right and lower edge of the adenoma. This is the adenoma. This is a normal parathyroid compressed to the right and lower edge of adenoma. This is adenoma. Mostly the chief cells are present. No water clear cells. These are all the adenoblastic proliferation of the adenomatous cells. That's all about the parathyroid gland. The hyperfunctioning, hypofunctioning, and the neoplastic condition. Next, coming to adrenal gland. Adrenal gland. So it consists of two separate endocrine glands. Adrenal means also called suprarenal gland. As I told you, it's present above the kidney, above the upper pole of kidney. Because of its position above the upper pole of kidney, it's called suprarenal, above the kidney, or adrenal. Adrenal means also the Greek word. or Latin wort, where it means again above the kidney. So adrenal gland. It consists of two separate endocrine glands within a single anatomical organ. So it is an example of an organ, single organ, but having two different glands. The adrenal cortex is one endocrine gland, and adrenal medulla is also another. Adrenal cortex is outer, inner one is adrenal medulla. So these two are actually two different endocrine glands that fuse together to form a single organ. You can understand like this. Two different endocrine glands fuse together to form a single organ. So single anatomical organ. So the cortex, the retinal cortex, is derived from mesoderm, and they produce steroid hormones. Okay, and the medulla is of a neural crest origin and produces catecholamines. Catecholamines means your adrenaline and noradrenaline. And cortex is from mesoderm producing steroid hormones like glucocorticoids and mineralocorticoids. Okay, like that. So coming to the adrenal cortex. In the adrenal, you have, I told you, one is cortex and one is medulla. Both two are two different endocrine glands, having two different, entirely different products and functions. So adrenal cortex. Adrenal cortex, here you find, okay. It consists of zona glomerulosa, the outer zona glomerulosa, which produces aldosterone. Okay, and zona fascicle is a mineral corticoid, important along with others. The important one is aldosterone, and other two are zona fasciculata and zona reticularis. They produce glucocorticoids and sex hormones. They produce both glucocorticoids and sex hormones. So, okay. This is aldosterone. The aldosterone will cause this. You know, the aldosterone. What is aldosterone function? It helps in salt retention. Salt retention from the kidneys. It prevents the excess secretion and reabsorption of salts. And when there is low kidney perfusion, low blood supply to kidney, there is activation of renin-angiotensin system that is called renin-angiotensin-aldosterone axis. You must have read in your physiology how the renin will stimulate angiotensin. The angiotensin is produced from the angiotensin converting enzyme, ACE. From angiotensin 1 to 2 like that, okay? The angiotensin converting enzyme producing angiotensin, and then it stimulates the aldosterone, which causes the salt and mineral retention, okay? It combats the or controls the fluid depletion or fluid loss, okay? And glucocorticoids, what they do? They inhibit protein synthesis, okay? And increase gluconeogenesis, okay? Inhibit protein synthesis, and increase glucose. Actually, here it is glucose. It's wrongly typed. Increase glucose synthesis. That's why it's called glucocorticoid. And also increase gluconeogenesis. Gluconeogenesis means increased production of glucose from non-carbohydrate sources. So that is different fats, fatty acids, and amino acids. They will also get converted to glucose. That is called gluconeogenesis. That is the production of glucose from non-carbohydrate sources like fatty acids or fats and glycerols and amino acids also. So it promotes more glucose production and inhibits protein synthesis. That is the function of glucocorticoids. Mineralocorticoids is the aldosterone, which prevents the fluid depletion and electrolyte depletion. That is produced by the adrenal cortex. That is zona glomerulosa, zona fasciculata, and zona reticularis. The reticularis produces mostly sex hormones. So coming to the different adrenal disorders, the hyperfunctioning of the adrenal gland will lead to these conditions, like excess cortisol, that is a glucocorticoid, it causes Cushing's syndrome, okay? And excess aldosterone, which is a mineral corticoid, it causes Kahn's syndrome. And excess sex hormones, that is from the zona reticularis of the adrenal cortex, it causes congenital adrenal hyperplasia, okay? That is called, it produces excess sex hormones, okay? And hypofunction, when they decrease function due to different causes, it causes acute decreased function or acute adrenal failure. That is called Waterhouse-Friderichsen syndrome. And chronic hypofunctioning causes Addison's disease. Okay, that is Cushing's disease, Addison's. Like that, we have different types of syndromes and effects due to hyperfunctioning and hypofunctioning of the different components of the adrenal cortex of glucocorticoids, mineralocorticoids, and sex hormones. Coming to Cushing's syndrome, I told you Cushing's syndrome is hyperfunctioning. hyper functioning of adrenal cortex, mostly your glucocorticoids. So mostly this Cushing syndrome is because of the exogenous causes, exogenous steroids. When more steroids are given to the patient from exogenously, from outside, like tablets or injections. Endogenous, inside the body, it's because of the, again, it has pituitary causes, where the pituitary producing more ACTH and more stimulation of the adrenal cortex and releasing more glucocorticoids. Or adrenal causes, where you have the adrenal hyperfunctioning or hyperplasia, adenoma, producing more glucocorticoids. Or ectopic, sometimes there is ectopic adrenal tissue in some other organs in the body. Ectopic location of these adrenal glands, where they also hyperfunction and they produce more of these adrenal corticoids. Like also in case of paraneoplastic syndrome, in case of lung tumors, they produce the ACTH-like molecules. So all of them will lead to hyperfunctioning of the adrenal cortex, or producing more glucocorticoids and causing Cushing syndrome. So there are so many causes you see, or so many mechanisms how it can occur. So the causes of Cushing syndrome are, pituitary causes are Cushing's disease, that is hypersecretion of ACTH by adenoma, causing bilateral adrenal cortical hyperplasia. Because the ACTH is produced pituitary in the brain, it will act on both the adrenal glands and both sides of the kidney and causes bilateral adrenal cortical hyperplasia. Nelson syndrome, well, the removal of adrenals can lead to enlargement of pituitary, okay, and producing more ACTH, okay, by this negative feedback mechanism or positive feedback mechanism. And adrenal cortical causes is the commonest cause of Cushing syndrome in children, and usually adenoma, that's called adenocortical adenoma, and rarely a carcinoma or hyperplasia. And ectopic means most commonly the motor cell carcinoma of lung, as I told you, the paraneoplastic syndrome. And they produce ACTH-like molecules which will act on the adrenal cortex to produce more these glucocorticoids and causing Cushing syndrome. Okay. So lab diagnosis is plasma ACTH level estimation, low dose dexamethasone test, 24-hour urine for free cortisol, that is a glucocorticoid, the best screening method, and high-dose dexamethasone test, that is a confirmatory test. Okay, these are the different tests, laboratory diagnosis of the Cushing syndrome. Next, coming to Kahn syndrome. Kahn syndrome, as I told you, is a condition where there is hyper-functioning or hyper-production of the aldosterone or mineral corticoid. So mineral corticoid will cause more water retention, more minerals retention, and there will be more of water, excess water accumulation. So that is Kahn syndrome because of the increased secretion of aldosterone. So most commonly from adrenal adenoma. So clinical features are more water retention, more salt retention leading to more hypertension because of more increase in blood volume, and also severe muscle weakness. Lab features is mild hypernatremia and hypokalemic metabolic alkalosis because of the water more dilution, and low plasma renin activity that will cause decrease the function of renin of kidney, as I told you, will be more suppressed. The low plasma renin activity and 24 hours urine excretion of potassium is the best screening method. Okay. So the excretion will be less. That is all about the Kahn syndrome. And there is the adrenogenital syndrome, as I told you, that is the zona reticularis of the adrenal cortex that produce the sex hormones. And when there is any hypersecretion, they cause the adrenogenital syndrome. Congenital adrenal hyperplasia, where there are inherited metabolic errors characterized by lack of enzymes involved in biosynthesis of corticosteroids, okay, in that case. And also steroidogenesis is then channeled into another pathway leading to excess of androgens. Okay. When excess of androgens means more virilization, means you find the excess manifestation of the male secondary sexual characteristics, more hair like that, more hair, more hoarse voice. So you find all these things in case of excess of androgen. And if it occurs in females, you find the androgenic manifestations like ambiguous genitalia, and also the male-like features in case of females. That is a male-like voice, more male-like, more hair in females like that, because if they produce more androgens because of this steroidogenesis, more and more sex hormones like males. So like this, it produces various abnormal situations, okay, in males and females. And some may also have deficient aldosterone leading to more salt wasting or more loss of these salts from the blood, and leading to dehydration and some other neurological disturbances. And commonest enzyme deficiency is 21-hydroxylase. And this congenital adrenal hyperplasia should be suspected in any neonate with ambiguous genitalia, any neonate newborn, where you know it's not clear whether ambiguous genitalia means no proper development of the external genitalia, and in that case you find it looks ambiguous, means more some confused state, whether it is a male or female you cannot know. So this ambiguous genitalia is because of this neonate, because I suspect the adenogenital syndrome, because of this steroidogenesis and virilization and all these things will be there, leading to these differences in the or disturbances in the formation of secondary sexual characteristics and also the development of the gonads will be affected. That is all about the adenogenital syndromes. Next, coming to acute adrenal insufficiency, the opposite of this, and the apoplexy. Okay, the apoplexy or adrenal apoplexy, where you find the sudden hemorrhage in the adrenal gland leading to destruction of the tissue, adrenal tissue, and there is insufficient production of the hormones. And Waterhouse-Friderichsen syndrome, caused by meningococcal septicemia. Okay, that is caused by meningococcal septicemia, and where you find more necrosis and more hemorrhage in the adrenal glands. That is called adrenal apoplexy or Waterhouse-Friderichsen syndrome, due to meningococcal meningitis and septicemia affecting the adrenal gland, where you find destruction of gland suddenly will lead to this insufficiency or hypofunctioning of the adrenal gland. Coming to Addison's disease, as I told you, the Addison's disease is the opposite of the Cushing's disease or Cushing's syndrome. There it was hyperfunctioning, here it is hypofunctioning. Okay. Where you find the destruction of adrenal gland and all the cells are destroyed, so there is less functioning of the adrenal gland and less production of these all these glucose and mineral corticoids. It causes maybe autoimmune adrenalitis, where the autoantibodies destroying the adrenal cortex cortical cells. Tuberculous adrenalitis also destruction, and metastatic neoplasms also, they also destroy the adrenal gland. The clinical features are weakness, hypotension, and hyperpigmentation, and lab features are hyponatremia and hyperkalemia. The opposite to the Cushing syndrome. So let's start. This is all about the different conditions of the adrenal cortex, the hyper and hypofunctioning, and tumors, and the side effects of all the syndromes. Next, coming to adrenal medulla. As you know, it's a different adrenal gland present inside the adrenal gland. Outer is the cortex, there is the medulla. So it's adrenal medulla. It is structurally and functionally distinct from adrenal cortex. Okay, both the glands occurring in the same anatomical organ, I told you. So most adrenal medullary disorders are neoplasms, like pheochromocytoma. There is a more proliferation of the medullary cells. Okay, as I told you, the medulla contains the cells producing adrenaline and noradrenaline. 80% is adrenaline and 20% noradrenaline. Opposite to your adrenergic neurons or nerves or sympathomimetic nerves, which produces more amount of noradrenaline, but here it is more amount of adrenaline. Okay, so it causes pheochromocytoma, neuroblastoma. A tumor of the primitive neural cells of the adrenal medulla, and ganglion neuroma. All these things affect the adrenal medulla. They are all the different tumors: pheochromocytoma, neuroblastoma, and ganglion neuroma. Coming to pheochromocytoma, the pheochromocytoma is an uncommon neoplasm derived from the adrenal medulla. The cells called chromaffin cells. Okay, that's why it's called pheochromocytoma. Also, it is called as paraganglioma. And these chromaffin cells actually produces the catecholamine secretions. That is more adrenaline. So there is more sympathomimetic effect on the heart and increased heart contractility and heart rate, and there is also more hypertension because of the increased heart rate and increased heart contraction. So there is more hypertension because of the adrenergic effect on the heart and also on the peripheral vessels, where they will constrict more, leading to hypertension. Okay, there is a sympathomimetic effect or adrenergic neurons causing vasoconstriction also. Okay, leading to hypertension. And it's a rare condition, but it's a very curable cause of hypertension, because when you remove the tumor, which is responsible for the more adrenaline, then automatically the BP is controlled. It's a curable cause of hypertension, and most are benign. Okay, most are benign, and because it's if you know the cause of the hypertension, we can cure. Here the cause is your pheochromocytoma producing more, having a proliferation of chromaffin cells and producing more adrenaline. So if that is controlled, the excess adrenaline source is stopped, and then the hypertension can be controlled. But without preventing the primary cause, if you keep on giving the antihypertensives also, no problem. The disease is not cured. So you have to clear the, you have to know the root cause, the exact cause of the disease. If the cause is cured, then the disease is cured. Rather than treating the symptoms or manifestations, we have to treat the cause of the disease. Okay. So you know, hypertension also, there are two types. So the primary hypertension, where the cause is not known, or cause is not, it is an inherent cause. There is no organic cause. And secondary means you have the underlying cause, like the organic causes. So the polyps are cured, then the hypertension or the excess blood pressure is cured. Like this is an example of pheochromocytoma. So here the rule of 10 is applied here. You have to remember easily. 10% of the cases of the pheochromocytoma are familial. They run in families. 10% of them are bilateral. They occur in both the adrenal glands, both the adrenal medullas of the both sides. And 10% are external adrenal because they also occur in the sites other than adrenal gland where you find these chromaffin cells. Okay. There are chromaffin cells found in the adrenal medulla. They are also found sometimes in other organs also, like in the lung and some other organs, GI tract also. That's called extra-adrenal pheochromocytoma or extra-adrenal paraganglioma, that's called. Okay. And 10% of them occur in children and 10% of them are malignant. Okay. The rule of 10. You remember this. These are all the features of the pheochromocytoma or paraganglioma of the adrenal gland. So lab diagnosis is by urinary excretion of the vanillyl mandelic acid. That is a byproduct or end product of the metabolism of the adrenaline. That is called as vanillyl mandelic acid. So when you estimate biochemical urinary levels, that will help in diagnosis or it will help you in supporting the diagnosis by this biochemical corroboration along with the clinical features and clinical examination. So grossly, if you find it is a brown solid nodules having areas of hemorrhage, necrosis, and microscopically when you see they are having many large polyhedral or polygonal cells and then in the form of nests, you can see the different nests like that, you can see the nests. So these are called gel balloon pattern, having these nests of these polygonal large polyhedral cells and having a rich vascular network. These are all the blood vessels. The very rich blood vessels or the vascular network is there, and this ball-like or nest-like arrangement of the large polyhedral cells of the, or the chromaffin cells is called as gel balloon. That pattern is called gel balloon pattern. So this is the gross and microscopic features of pheochromocytoma. And also confirmation by chromaffin reaction, where you find the section of the tumor at the bottom has been placed into a dichromate fixative chemical which turns the tissue brown. Okay, it becomes brown because of the presence of catecholamines or adrenaline becomes brown when you add the dichromate fixative. So this also confirms the diagnosis of pheochromocytoma. So this is all about pheochromocytoma. So this completes the pheochromocytoma. Next is neuroblastoma. Okay, neuroblastoma. I think I can tell in the next class. Okay, let me stop here. We'll continue tomorrow. Tomorrow again you have a class. I will continue the endocrine disorders. We have still some more are there. We'll continue. Okay. It will take two or three more classes. Let me try. We finish it in two classes. Then we can discuss some other topics. Okay. Thank you.